lab on analog electronic circuits. So in this video we'll see the working of rectifiers and regulators. So let us start now. Okay, now we will see first the half wave rectifiers and regulators. So in this remote lab we have all these possible experiments for half wave rectifier. We have rectification, and then we have with C filter we're going to see how does the rectified voltage will be improved, and we'll have a line regulation, and then certainly we have a load regulation. So let us start with half wave rectifier. So as we know, okay, this is the circuit diagram of a half wave rectifier. In this particular remote lab we are using a transformer with an input voltage of AC 230 volt with 50 hertz frequency signal, and the secondary is actually 909 transformer. So we are exclusively using a center tap transformer so that we can use the same transformer for other rectifiers also, like okay, full wave rectifiers and the bridge rectifier. So just for having same transformer for all other experiments, we are choosing on the secondary 909 transformer. And then you can see for this half wave rectifier, so we are certainly applying this AC signal to this transformer, and we are using analog discovery to measure the value or the waveform at the input of the rectifier using channel 1, that is C1 plus will give me the voltage at the input of the rectifier, and the channel 2 I will going to see the output rectifier signal at the second channel. And of course with the assumption of the transformer rating as 909 and the value of R is equal to 1K, we know what is the peak voltage. So if it is 909, I'll going to have 18 as the RMS voltage. The corresponding peak voltage will be 25.4, and the expected DC voltage as per this particular equation happens to be 8.1. And of course we are assuming a diode drop of 0.7. Of course we can certainly measure what is the diode drop there. So these are the values that are calculated using this, and then let us try to measure what are the values that we are actually getting. So now I can start conducting the experiment. You can see I can say conduct experiment. I think you might have heard that sound of relay ticking. Okay, this is that waveform what we are getting now. So as it was mentioned that this is channel 1, because it is 909 transformer, so by default the range would be 0.5. so we have to properly set the range. Suppose if it is at 0.5, we may not see the waveform properly. Make sure that volts per division and times per division are sufficient enough so that you can able to clearly see the waveform, at least 2 to 3 waveforms, 2 to 3 cycles of the input waveform and the corresponding output voltage. So since you have to measure the signals, what you can do is you can just make this single whole window and then try to measure it. So the parameters that need to be measured are, you can see what is the frequency of the input signal, and of course you can find out what is the peak of this input voltage and what is the peak of output voltage. You can see there is a difference between the input peak and output peak, which will be due to that diode drop of which is here. You can see this is C1, this is C2, in between that I have a diode. So naturally this separation has to be 0.7 or 0.65, whatever the voltage which corresponds to diode drop. Let us measure all those things. So to measure that, okay, I can go to this view measurements, and then let me add defined measurements. So in channel 1, let me see what is the maximum amplitude. Let me see what is what exactly more I want is, okay, vertical wise that is enough. In horizontal, let me know the frequency of the input signal. In channel 2, there is no need to measure the horizontal parameter. Let me measure what is the average voltage of my rectifier signal, which gives me the DC voltage, and let me also see what is the maximum voltage, so that the difference between the two maximas will give me the diode drop. That is, this difference happens to be the diode drop. Okay, now suppose if you just have a look at this one, I can stop it so that these values are stable. You can see C1 happens to be 24.79, so this is C1 maximum. If you can see C2 maximum, it is 24.01. so if you see the difference between C1 and C2 maximums, which is the maximum of this and this, it is coming out to be almost 0.78 voltage, 0.78 volts, so which is the diode drop. and you can see the frequency is 50 hertz. So we assume that the frequency of the signal is 50 hertz. It's almost there. So whatever signal that I've applied is the real raw signal at this point of time. And then the average voltage is 9.63 volts. So we expected a voltage of 8.1. This is as per calculation. And what you're getting exactly at this real time is 9.63 volts. So this is the DC voltage. So this way we can able to clearly find out, so what is the input voltage that we applied and what is the DC voltage that you are getting, and of course what is the diode drop. So using this particular experiment, I can able to know what is the diode drop, that is diode is consuming in terms of voltage, and what is the DC voltage for an applied voltage of peak voltage of 24.7 volts. So once we are done with this, we can certainly move on to next part of the experiment, which is you can see now we are adding a capacitor. So there are two possible capacitors that can be added. So let me just show here. I can use either 100 microfarad or 470 microfarad. Suppose if I select this 100 microfarad, so we know the ripple voltage is given by V peak minus of VD on divided by FRC, where F is the frequency, R is the resistance, and C is the value of capacitance. Since I'm using a capacitance of 100 microfarad, so with these as the values, theoretically we are assuming, so we are supposed to get 1.08 as the peak to peak voltage, the ripple voltage, for with the value of C is equal to 470 microfarad. If the capacitance is less, then you won't have larger ripple voltage. So since we are using it as 100 microfarad first, so let me just conduct the experiment. You can see as soon as I say conduct the experiment, you can see I'm getting the ripple voltage now. So what I can do is now I can just measure what is the peak to peak of this. So instead of measuring, okay, along with this, what I can do is, okay, maybe we can remove all these things just to make sure that we are measuring only the required parameters. So especially in case of this particular filter circuit, so I'm interested in knowing what is the peak voltage. Is of course not okay, you can find out what is the peak voltage and then what is VD on here, so you can measure that voltage, and of course you can also measure what is the ripple voltage. So ripple voltage can be easily measured by going for second channel and then go for vertical, measure peak to peak of it. So this will give me the peak to peak of this one, and then I can go to channel 1 and I can see what is maximum. This is actually the V peak of input voltage. Suppose if I go here and then find out what is maximum here, it is again the maximum of this one. This is actually VP minus of VD on. So this itself is VP minus VD on, which is 22.9 divided by FRC. Divided by FRC happens to be the denominator of this equation, because I have this equation. As per this equation, it is VP minus VD on, that is the voltage, the peak voltage of your capacitor, that happens to be C2 maximum is 22.98, which is almost 23 volt. So you can substitute 23 divided by 50 hertz into R is equal to 1 kilo ohms and C is equal to 100 microfarad. You can theoretically find out what is the value of V ripple, and you can also note down what is the measured value. Maybe you can stop here and then see what is the value that you are getting. You are getting a value of 3.8 volts. So this is the ripple voltage with the value of C is equal to 100 microfarad. Maybe you can repeat the same experiment by selecting the value of C, that is 470 microfarad. So you can conduct the experiment. You can see as soon as the value of C has increased from 100 to 470 microfarad, the ripple voltage has reduced. You can certainly measure what is the ripple voltage. You can see now the ripple voltage has reduced to 0.85 volts. Of course, as per this, it is supposed to be 1.05. So these are all the expected values. So provided all these voltages are so and so, you can certainly measure what is the peak voltage, peak to peak voltage of output voltage, which is now almost 0.85 volt. So this way we can able to see the impact of capacitor on the ripple voltage. As the capacitance value increases, the ripple voltages keep reducing as per the equation which is observed here also. Of course, we don't have the option of changing the value of R. So that is one limitation in this remote lab. We are not changing the value of R here. So now let us go to line regulation. In this line regulation, you can carefully observe. I can select either 7805 or 7812 regulator. You know that these are the two regulators which are basically used to get plus 5 volts and plus 12 volts. So this is the actual circuit diagram which is used to get the line regulation, to observe the line regulation. As the circuit indicates here, at the input of the regulator, I am applying a rectifier signal. You can see there is no capacitor or the resistor. Whatever the input resistance of this regulator is there, that itself will be used as the resistance for this whatever rectifier you have for current to complete the path. So that will be the rectified input, and at the output you're going to have a regulated output voltage if the input voltage exceeds certain minimum voltage. So that is what is we are looking at now. So we have selected 7805. Let me say conduct experiment, and you can see here this is my let us again remove all these things and then let me just stop it here. If you can carefully observe here, so this is the input voltage that is being applied to the input of the regulator, and this is the output of the regulator. So if I go back and see here, this is channel 1, this is channel 2. In channel 1, I'm not seeing an input voltage, but it is a rectified signal. So that's why you can see it's a halfway rectified signal. In channel 2, what I'm seeing is regulated voltage. So when it will be get regulated, we know that. So we are writing here the minimum DC voltage at the input voltage, for minimum voltage that is required at the input is 7.5. that is, we're just writing it a typical value. You can actually measure what is the voltage that is required to get a constant voltage of 5 volts for 7805. For that, what I can do is I can just put few cursors. I'm just putting few cursors now. Can see I'll put few X cursors, maybe 4 or 5. Let me just place them appropriately so that I can able to know what is the input and output voltage before your output is get regulated and after output is get regulated. Let me also find out at what input voltage you'll get a constant voltage, which is in this case it is 5.5. let me take few more cursors. See now this. Okay, I can take few more. Now let me just take this up now. Okay, fine. If you can carefully observe this, as the input voltage is keep increasing from 0, now it is 1.4, the output is 0.53, the input is 3 point something, it is still 0.9, 4.3, it is 3 volt, and it is 5.7, it is 4.7. can see 6.5, it is 5.5, 13.5, 5.5, it is 22, it is 5.5, it is 24, 5.5. The understanding of these input and output is, if the input voltage exceeds 6.5 here, you can see for any voltages beyond 6.5, output voltage is regulated to 5.5 volts. Even though it is 7805, it was supposed to regulate at 5 volts, so because of the typical regulator, we are getting a regulation at 5.5 volts. So this regulator is having a constant voltage of 5.5 volts when the input voltage exceeds 6.5. so this is what is line regulation. We can certainly see, of course, for seeing the line regulation, we have the input voltage which is a rectified signal, and the output voltage is again, it is following the input voltage to some extent, and then it becomes constant, which can be observed here also in the transfer characteristics. So which I can just make it something over here, and the same thing is observed here. You can see here the input voltage is keep increasing. This is your x-axis input voltage, y-axis output voltage. So when the input voltage is exceeding, you can see output is for some period it is constant, for some input voltages then it is keep increasing. And for input voltages which is almost greater than 6.5, you can see it is fairly constant. So in this particular experiment, there is no point in measuring any like a peak-to-peak voltage or average voltage. So what we are observing is how does the output voltage is changing when the input voltage is gradually varying from zero to a larger value. So this is what is known as the line regulation. This is what we expect in line regulation, which can be very clearly observed by putting few cursors at appropriate points. Why we are putting these many cursors is so that you can able to see how does the input voltage is increasing, how does the output is increasing simultaneously, and finally for larger input voltages output becomes constant. So we are also looking at a very specific value where it is, you can see it's almost becoming constant here. For input voltages beyond 6.6, it can see it's almost 5.5. So here it is constant. So similar type of analysis can be done for 7812 also. You can see I can select 7812. I can just keep this in I can keep this in run mode. Let me just take out this. I'll put it in run mode and let me select 7812. Let me conduct now. Can you see now this is the reading for 7812. So what I can do, I can stop it now. I can do the similar type of analysis what I did it for 7805. This is for 7812. I'm just placing the cursors appropriately so that I can able to this is very important. I'm just placing exactly at that point where it is fairly becoming constant at 12.4 volt. It was supposed to be there at 12 volt, but because of typical nature of the practical regulator, I'm getting it at 12.4. So this is my voltage. You can see now this how you can see as the input is keep increasing, output is also increasing up to certain extent, but after 13.8 it is fairly becoming constant. It is at 12.4 again as we did it for 7805. Here also we can just have a look at for the, you can see this is now keep increasing. It is, of course, you can just make this to go off. So if I just do it like this, okay, this goes off. Okay, let me just see from zero itself. Okay, this would be fine. Okay, what you're getting this is exactly a representation of that. So you can see it is going up to 12.4. So any voltages beyond 13.8, it becomes almost constant. So this is what is line regulation. And then we'll move on to the next experiment, that is load regulation, where we are changing the just have a look at the circuit that we have it for load regulation. You can see for load regulation I have to apply a input voltage which is more than minimum required to get a constant voltage of 12 volt or 5 volt. So that's why we are putting a capacitor here. The capacitor will ensure that the voltage of the input will never drop below the minimum required value. So let me select again 7805. Here we have three different loads. As you can see here, I have a no load, I have a load of 100 ohm, I have a 20 ohm and 10 ohm. So let me first select no load and then let me keep it in run. Okay, let me just remove all these things. Okay, I will remove all. So I have removed all. Of course, let me just conduct now. If you can carefully observe the type of waveform that you have, again you can see the channel one is showing me what is the input that is applied to the regulator, which is a filtered waveform. You can see it is a filtered waveform. The channel 2, if you can see, this is my channel 2 where I'm observing a regulated voltage which is a constant DC, because the input here is always more than minimum what is required to regulate. Here if the input voltage is more than 6.8, output is constant at 5. Let us see what is that voltage we have. Okay, what we are interested in measuring here is, so we want to see what is this minimum voltage at the input. If the minimum voltage is more than 6.5, the output voltage is constant at 5.5 or 5.3 volts. Let me just stop this here. This is we are actually doing it for no load. Let me just try to measure what is the voltage minimum here for channel 1. So that will give me what is the minimum input that you are applying. Of course, you can, that is the main thing that is required. In channel 2 I can measure what is the average voltage, so I can measure just the average voltage. You can see minimum itself is 18, so average is, since this 18 is certainly more than 6.5, so you are bound to get a constant voltage of 5.4 for the entire range of input voltage. You can see this is of course by this you can able to find out what is the current that is okay, we can able to know what is the voltage. Now we know that okay, as we increase the load current, suppose if I reduce the resistance the current increases, so naturally we know that this output voltage will slightly drop as I start loading the regulator. Now you can see I'm loading with 20 ohm. Just observe that the voltage has reduced from 4.5 to from 5.4 to 4.5. It is happening because we are actually loading the regulator. When you load the regulator, output voltage slightly reduces. So you can just again note what is this voltage here. You can stop it now. You can measure the voltage. The average voltage is 4.5. The minimum voltage is still 18. So this is one set of reading. You can repeat this with much more increased load current. That is, you reduce the resistance, current will increase. You can see conduct. You can see it has further reduced. You can see the voltage has become 4.1. Now you are trying to draw more current through the regulator, so regulator output voltage will certainly reduce. So this way we can able to conduct the load regulation also for different regulator. I can repeat the same thing for 7812 also. Now this is for 7812. I will certainly first select the no load. You can see for no load it is 12.3 volt, almost 12.4. You can do it for, okay, let me just repeat it for different loads. Now I'm loading it with 20 ohm resistance. You can see this has reduced to 12 volt from 12.4. I will make it 10 ohm. You can see when I conduct, you can see it has lost the shape. Now it is 11.8 volts. Now you can see as you keep loading the regulator, the output is also distorted, and of course you have a reduced output voltage. This is what is known as the load regulation. Okay, even for load regulation, as we did it in 7805, in 7812 also, you have a capacitor so that input voltage should never go down less than minimum which is required to regulate the voltage. So these are some typical values and these are the observed values. Maybe don't keep this in load condition for a longer time. Make it no load and then make your regulator safe so that it is not being loaded with heavy currents. So this way we can able to comfortably conduct the experiment on half wave rectifiers. There are actually 11 different combinations that we have performed. So this is going to help you in understanding the entire concept of half wave regulator, filtering using C filter and the line regulation as well as load regulation. Hope okay, this will going to help you in understanding the entire band of rectifiers and regulators, especially for half-wave rectifier.